interrupt our program to bring you this important message.
Find my balls, for God's sakes. One, two, and three. Okay, I'm okay.
Well, if that wasn't just a kick in the nuts this week, holy crap, guys. We're recording on Wednesday night here, just hours after Jim Harbaugh Day came to an unceremonious end. I mean, we're all sitting there. I mean, I was refreshing Twitter like every 30 seconds to a minute for most of the day doing it. I was, okay, where's the stuff?
I think anybody that follows this team really hard was doing the same thing all day today too.
Yep. And then about 6:30 p.m. Central Time here Wednesday night, we get the tweet of death from Adam Schefter saying that Jim Harbaugh had called Michigan and informed them that he was coming back and he was giving up his...
You sent me that tweet and my stomach just dropped right away.
I know, because I had just posted something on Twitter about, you know, about waiting, and then not... 2 minutes later, Schefter put that tweet on. I'm like, son of a... And for the record, guys, we had a great thing all set up. I had the outfit, I had the khakis, I had the pullover and everything else. I was going to be all dressed up like that in celebration of Harbaugh Day. Had an entire set list welcoming Jim Harbaugh to the Vikings. Well, you know what we can do with this?
Yep.
Fuck it.
Yeah.
Jim, the dream of Jim Harbaugh is done.
Man, being a Vikings fan is not an easy task.
No, it's not. But not 5 minutes after the news broke that that Harbaugh was out of the running, came from multiple sources, including Ian Rappaport from NFL Network, Tom Pelissero from... you know, and he's another big time Vikings writer, and some of the local guys, that the Vikings were placing calls to both Mr. Morris. Graham and Raheem Morris, telling them that they were also out of the running for the coaching job, which means our new head coach, ladies and gentlemen, granted, this is unofficial, cannot be announced until after the Super Bowl. But the 10th,
somebody doesn't change his mind,
right? But as it sits right now, as of Wednesday night at 10:35 p.m., when Lance and I are recording here, the 10th head coach in Minnesota Vikings history will be current Rams offensive coordinator Kevin O'Connell. So the McVay tree comes to Minnesota, which would be kind of interesting because, of course, we also have the McVay tree over in Cheeseland over there with Cram It Up Your Cram Hole, LaFleur.
I'm not even going to try to fake my excitement right now. I don't know how to feel today, honestly.
I mean,
I'm happy that we found our coach. Am I happy how everything played out? Not really. I feel like I was, I felt honestly violated after today. It's just, I don't know, man. I don't know what to say to that, but I felt like a balloon. I was blowing up and then just slowly deflated.
Yeah. And I mean, you know, I said this last week and I said it for the last couple of weeks that I thought Kevin O'Connell was going to get the job. I also said, you know, a month ago or whatever, that there was zero chance that Jim Harbaugh was going to be coach of the Vikings. And that almost came to reality.
The thing that makes me upset, this is what I was getting at, was that I was sold on these three guys.
Yeah.
You know, before this Harbaugh shit hit the fan, excuse my language, one for the swear jar. But I was sold on these three finalists. And then for Harbaugh to jump in, it just took me to a whole nother level. And I was like, all right. And then you get these reports.
Well, yeah. I mean, basically it was sitting there. Okay. You have a choice of a new Dodge Challenger. You have a new Chevy Camaro and you have a new Ford Mustang. And all of a sudden somebody pulls up and say, hey, I got keys to a brand new Chevy Corvette here. Who wants them?
Right.
You know? And I mean, I bought into
old school Camaro that still, you know, has got some mileage on it, but still runs really good.
Right. I mean, I was all in on the Harbaugh thing once it broke, you know.
The thing that is they sold it so well. It was like he was our coach already.
Yeah. I mean, it was being said that the job is Harbaugh's if he wants it, blah, 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 you know. And now the interesting part about that, there was a couple of things. One, there is a minority owner for the Minnesota Vikings named Jim Stapleton, who is a University of Michigan alum. And for whatever reason, this guy's got some kind of a hard on for the Michigan coaches. He literally got his sideline passes revoked when Rich Rodriguez was the coach up there because of something he did. And then apparently he was pounding the table. Even though Kwesi wanted Jim Harbaugh from all accounts, but Stapleton was one of the guys that was in there saying, no, don't hire Harbaugh. It's a big mistake. Don't want this guy in there. So I don't know if Jim told him to get the hell off the field one time or something when he was trying to be up there being Mr. Big Shot or what the deal was, but he had some kind of beef with Jim Harbaugh. Jim Stapleton did. I don't know if that played any part into it. I also heard that Harbaugh's salary demands were in that John Gruden range, the 10-year, $100 million range, which, I mean, if it would have won us a Super Bowl, absolutely, I don't care. And I think Harbaugh could have got us to a Super Bowl. I really do.
Yeah.
Drew and I were talking about this earlier, and, you know, we talked about it. I guess, spot it on their live show they did Wednesday night. They, you know, we talked about it on there for a little bit too. Harbaugh very likely would have gotten us to a Super Bowl. But I think the thing, and I think part of it, they're saying that Harbaugh basically backed out at the end of the day himself. It's not that the will said no. But, you know, I'm wondering if part of it may have been the money. You know, that's a very likely scenario. The Wills to say, no, we're not going to commit to a 10-year contract with you. Because if you look at Harbaugh's history, he's usually good for 4 to 5 years in a location. Then he kind of burns out and then moves on to the next spot. But also, you know, there's
reasons why that happens. I mean, who's to say that would happen here?
Well, maybe it wouldn't happen here. I mean, he's been in Michigan for 7 years now, but there's also the rumblings that I've been hearing and talking to people tonight and everything else, that it's very possible that Kwesi and the Wilfs went in and said, Jim, we're in trouble here with the cap. We've got issues. We've got a lot of bloated contracts and the salary. We're in salary cap hell right now.
Right.
We're going to have to move on from some of these high contract players, you know, guys.
Some like Jim wanted to come in and with the roster as is and make a good shot.
Right. Yeah. I'm wondering, and this is purely my opinion, pure speculation. I don't have this on good authority from anybody, but the fact that, you know, Harbaugh probably didn't want to sign up for being the coach of a rebuilding team, which in the long run is what this team needs to do.
Yeah. And you know what? In another positive light, rebuilds aren't taking as long as they had in the past either, it seems like.
No. I see see people talking on the social media.
Look at the Bengals. It's a prime example.
Yeah. But I'm seeing people, oh, we're going to suck for the next 5 years. No, you do it right, you can do a turnaround in a couple of years.
Damn. I believe in a three-year plan, man.
Yeah.
For sure.
If we haven't made significant progress within 3 years, then it's.
And then at the end of the day, I mean, it all comes down to the players and if they're buying in, mm-hmm. If they're getting it.
And that's the thing. Now, you know, we've gone the full youth movement. Kwesi is 40 years old.
Right. O'Connell's young in football yep. standards.
And O'Connell is
the opposite guys.
O'Connell is 36. So, I mean, these guys aren't far removed from the, I mean, there's going to be players on the team that are close to the same age as, you know, as Kevin is.
You know, Kevin has his red flags, but as does any new head coach right. coming in. A couple of things I'm sorry, Kevin, I don't mean to disrespect you, but this is what I'm reading and digesting myself. Some of the things I don't like is that he doesn't call plays. He's never called plays, you know. In Los Angeles there.
Yeah.
They do say that he has a lot going into the game planning as far as scripting the first 15 plays of the game goes.
He does most of the game setup, and then McVay just does the in-game play calling kind of thing. Now, I mean, I'm not going to disqualify he's obviously not disqualified because he's by all accounts getting the job.
Right.
But, you know, you look at the current McVay tree, which is producing more, it has already produced more than Bill Belichick's tree has. And Belichick's been coaching for 30 years. I mean, you look, Matt LaFleur in Green Bay, 13-3, 13-3, 13-4, made it to the NFC right. Championship game 2 of the 3 years. He never called the plays until he got to Green Bay and he started out. Zach Taylor in Cincinnati, you know, he had his first couple of years were rough. He was like 4-25 or whatever it was. But then all of a sudden you get Joe Burrow in there, which Joe Burrow makes a big difference. I'm not going to discount that at all. But they're going to the Super Bowl this year.
So what do you think O'Connell does with Kirk here? I've heard two sides of the story too here. This
I know. I hear a lot of people saying, oh, O'Connell worked with, because O'Connell was Kirk's quarterback's coach in 2017, his last year in Washington.
But is O'Connell going to want his own guy?
Well,
that he brings in, that he grooms.
I mean, we can have this discussion in a little more depth.
Right.
At a later show here.
We will.
Yeah. You know, I'm seeing that on social media. I've been seeing that all night. Oh, it's O'Connell. He knows Kirk. Kirk's staying, blah, 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 blah.
I've also heard it could be the opposite of that.
I honestly, this is my honest opinion right now, and I could be way off base, but I don't think I am. I think going this route now, I honestly think Kirk stood a better chance of staying had we gone with Harbaugh.
I agree. Absolutely. Yes.
Then we do it with O'Connell, because when we're coming in with O'Connell, I think they're looking more long-term to the future.
Yep.
You know, getting out from underneath this cap hell that we're at, 2022 probably is not. I mean, a lot of it depends on what happens, you know, in Green Bay with Aaron Rodgers and whatnot.
The situation is very telling for O'Connell as well, as far as like a security blanket that the Wolves are giving this guy.
Right.
You would think, you know, the leash is fairly long for O'Connell for a couple of years anyways, because.
Yeah. No, this isn't going to be a Cleveland Browns or Houston Texans thing. If you don't go from 4-12 to 12-4 in a year, you're gone kind of thing. And that's one thing you give the Wolves credit for. They're patient and they like stability. So they're not going to go knee jerk firing coaches left and right. They're going to give O'Connell and Kwesi time to try to build this team, modernize things, and go that way.
You know what? And they say what they did what they said they were going to do.
Mm-hmm.
They casted a wide net. They interviewed, you know, between 8 to 10 candidates. You know, what was it, 9 now with Harbaugh in there?
Yeah, 9 coaches, yeah.
So, I mean, and they narrowed it down. Granted, there was some fire in there with the Harbaugh, you know, with the heat coming up from that. Let's just hope that they made the right decision here.
Mm-hmm. And, I mean, I've been reading stuff from multiple places now tonight, you know, once it was basically unofficially announced that O'Connell's getting the job, you know, people that have worked with him in the past coming out. Apparently, from what was being said out of Washington, is there was a lot of people that were tabbing him to take over for Jay Gruden when things were going wrong there. And that was 3 years ago.
Right.
So, you know, I know there's a lot of people that are upset, burning things down, so on and so forth tonight.
You know what, though?
Again, Wednesday. But
at the end of the day, Rhino?
Yep.
In my most eloquent of ways of saying this, people need to get the fuck over it. They need to get over it and move forward because it is what it is.
Yeah, but this is going to be my last word on the Harbaugh thing. Jim Harbaugh actually did something that nobody else has been able to do. That he brought Vikings social media together and united them as one for like 24 hours. Because 90% of the people were on the Harbaugh train. They were ready to roll. They were this, they were that, they were everything else.
I don't know. I've seen a lot of naysayers out there too, honestly.
But watching the stuff the way I normally do.
Yeah.
You know, like you
there
say
was a lot of buzz.
You say the name of our current quarterback on social media, and it's World War III.
Right down the fucking middle, man.
you got two sides pushing the red button and dropping nukes on everything.
I guess it was inevitable. Let this be our final battle. Stop it. Kyle, that's too hard. Kyle, stop it. Quit it, Kyle.
It's like being in prison, man. You can't just be neutral. You got to pick somebody.
Yeah.
I mean, we get crucified if we just, you know, are critical of Kirk at all. Oh, right. God, you guys hate Kirk. You guys hate Kirk. Fuck you guys. You know, from the Kirkistanis. Well, no, we just call it, like, we just do what we always have done and call it like it is.
And it's not just Kirk, any player. If they deserve praise, we praise them. If they deserve rippage, we will rip them.
Right.
But one other thing on we talked about Kevin O'Connell's background a couple weeks ago, you know, when we did the breakdown, but one interesting tidbit I saw here today, and this will kind of lead us into the NFL news portion of this. We decided to do the coaching talk ahead or first. This little interesting tidbit will roll us into the current NFL news. Kevin O'Connell was drafted in the third round in 2008.
New England
to be Tom Brady's backup in Tom's 8th year in the league, and O'Connell becomes a head coach within 3 days after Tom Brady announces his retirement. Huh. So I mean, that tells you something about Brady and also O'Connell getting a job at 36. So,
right.
But with that, we'll roll into the NFL news, and there is a ton this week.
Yeah,
You know, of course, off weekend, no games after the conference championships, where the Rams will face Joe Burrow and the Cincinnati Bengals, which they slayed the dragon in Kansas City, which was impressive as all hell. But as we had mentioned with Tom Brady, last Saturday, Adam Schefter had tweeted that Brady was retiring And then it was like 3 days of a shit show. Everybody was saying, no, he hasn't made a decision. This, that, and
nobody
else.
Knew what was going on.
Brady himself the night or on Monday night on his podcast show that he does said, you know, I'm still taking time to decide this, this, and everything else. And then, Tuesday morning on his Instagram account, he announces his retirement. So basically he was pissed that he didn't get to do it himself first. So he drug it out for 3 days and then finally decided, but the GOAT Tom Brady has retired from the NFL, which interestingly opens up another open quarterback spot. So, you know, we'll talk about that.
Don't even say it, man. We'll
save that for a later date. In other news,
get subscribers here, man.
Right. in other news, Josh McDaniels has been named the new head coach of the Las Vegas Raiders. And as of Wednesday night, he hasn't changed his mind and decided to go back to New England yet. The Don't Blame Me tour of one Rick Spielman has been going around the last couple of weeks. He's been going on a lot of these shows and podcasts and whatnot, basically throwing Mike Zimmer under the bus and trying to absolve himself of any blame.
Mm-hmm.
Now this week, Zimmer's Maxim model girlfriend came out on Instagram and started firing back at Rick a little bit. Zimmer has been keeping his mouth shut, kind of hiding in the background. Yeah. And the way it sounds as of right now, he has no plans to
come out and talk.
No. Then the next one here, as of Wednesday morning, the Washington whatevers, what the football team, whatever, you know, as we've jokingly called them, have a new name.
The Commies, our Commanders, excuse me.
Yes. The Washington football team is now the Washington Commanders. I don't hate the name. I could think of better ones to have. Personally, I want them to be the
Red Hogs, man.
I want them to be the Sentinels, like out of the movie, The Replacements, but, then they could have, they could have had some fun with that one, but, they could have got Shane Falco in for quarterback then, but, beyond
the Red
that,
Hogs, man, the Red Hogs.
Yeah. Beyond that, did you see the one that everybody was freaking out that we didn't get? Did you see Ryan Poles' press conference with the Bears? Oh my God.
I think we dodged a bullet on that one, boys.
I think so too. I mean, he was sitting there. Hold on. Who am I and what am I about? We want to build through the draft. We want to. I mean, it sounded like
I'm going to take the North and never give it back.
He sounded like a fourth grader who's never spoken public before. Now,
granted, I mean,
yeah, it's a press conference. It's whatever. But if you look at Kwesi's introductory press conference versus Poles' press conference,
opposites.
I mean, the eloquence level between the two of them is just—it's not even close.
Right. I'm glad now, we got what we got as far as to this point.
Yeah. And now, I mean, Eberflus's conference wasn't that great either. Gesundheit. when it boils down to it, it really doesn't matter if the guy can speak in public or not. I mean, Rick Spielman stuck his head out of his office like once a year and talked to the press. It all boils down to the results that we're going to have. You know, and we won't even know for a couple of years down the road till we see what these guys come up with. But I think we got the right guy. Then another note today.
Time will tell, Rhino. Time will tell.
Absolutely. Also announced on Wednesday, Clint Kubiak and his coloring book are headed to Denver to be the quarterback's coach and passing game coordinator for the Broncos under new head coach Nathaniel Hackett. Good for Clint, I guess.
Right.
Wish him well, you know, hopefully he learned what not to do working for Zimmer for a year. I think honestly, going back to, you know, being a quarterback's coach and taking a step back from the coordinator thing is a good idea. Get him some more experience. Yeah, and
agree.
You know, and it's possible down the road, he could still turn out to be a very good coordinator. He could possibly be a head coach someday. I mean, like I said, 5 years ago, the guy was a wide receivers coach for Kansas State. So he doesn't have a whole lot of experience with anything in the NFL. So then the last big bit of news, and this thing is a freaking bombshell. Brian Flores, former coach of the Miami Dolphins, came out beginning of the week filing a class action lawsuit against the NFL and also naming he unnamed 29 teams, but then also but named the Giants, the Dolphins, and the Broncos by name for racism and hiring and some other stuff. Apparently this all started because Bill Belichick screwed up. He had caught wind.
I'm surprised he even knows I had a text message.
He had caught wind that Brian Daboll was going to get the job in New York as the head coach. And of course, Daboll being or worked for Belichick at one point. So apparently Belichick was meaning to text Brian Daboll and accidentally texted
him, right?
To congratulate him and accidentally texted Brian Flores, who he texted him on like Tuesday. And Flores wasn't interviewing until Wednesday. So, you know, Flores got kind of pissed at being the sham interview and everything else and went and filed a class action lawsuit. Now, also with the Dolphins, this is potentially could be very bad for owner Stephen Ross.
It was bad to begin with.
Right.
It just got a lot worse.
But there was a couple of things. The year before they ended up drafting Tua, apparently, and this is according to Flores anyway, Stephen Ross told him that he would pay him an extra $100,000 for every game that he lost because he was trying to tank in order to get the best draft pick possible.
Right.
And then apparently got upset towards the end of the year when Flores's system started clicking and they started winning a few games here and there. Because if they would have lost out and got the first overall pick, they would have gotten Joe Burrow. But instead, they picked like sixth and ended up with Tua Tagovailoa.
Shame on him.
Mm-hmm. But then,
honestly, what a fucking stain on the league that is.
Right. But then probably even worse than that is 2 years ago, Stephen Ross had invited Flores out to his yacht to for lunch. And apparently dropped it that there was a certain unnamed all pro quarterback that was joining them for lunch. And by all reports, it was Tom Brady. But Flores said he told Ross straight out. He said, that's tampering. He said, I will have no part of it.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, that led to part of the problems. And then he also, with the Denver Broncos, he also mentioned that when he interviewed for the job out there, when Vic Fangio ultimately ended up getting the job, that when he came in the morning for his interview, Elway and whoever all else was involved came in.
Wasted.
Yeah, they were hungover and had a, you know, basically went an all-night bender with whoever they were interviewing the day before. And he said basically they just kind of went through the motions asking him half-assed lame questions, this, that, and everything else. Now, here again, is this true? We don't know. It's, you know, his accounting of things. We know he's disgruntled for being let go from Miami. Is there truth to this stuff? It very well possibly could be. I mean, we know a lot of this stuff that goes on behind the scenes with these owners
it's pretty nasty, apparently.
Right. But, you know, unless you're the Washington Commanders, then the only person that gets in trouble is John Gruden for sending nasty emails to somebody. But,
right.
You know,
scapegoat John.
Right. This could potentially blow up in the league's face and it could be really bad.
Exactly.
But I mean, if this stuff is going on, it probably needs to blow up.
Yeah.
Honestly, like it does. But anyway, that's really all we've got for the news. So with that, we're going to roll into another one of our classic beer commercials since we didn't have one last week during our live show. But you guys head to the fridge, crack one open, Check this out, and we'll be back in a minute.
Leon, you sign a record contract in the offseason. You come in with great numbers, Hall of Fame caliber numbers. But since then, disappointment. Your numbers are down. Who's to blame?
Well, Chuck, in this situation, I first have to look at myself.
The great ones do.
Right. So since you and I both know that can't be it, I gotta blame the fans and the media. Then after that, it's the linemen's fault, it's the coach's fault, the owner's fault, the turf, referees, announcers. May even be your fault, Chuck.
All righty, we are back. Now, as most of you already know, there is no NFL games this weekend of any magnitude anyway. The Pro Bowl is this weekend. Now, the big question is, does anybody care?
I quit caring about the Pro Bowl about the mid-2000s, man. Mm-hmm. Early 2000s. Yeah. They need to fix this. They need to fix it. They need to find something to fix this. I mean, it's not what it once was.
No, I mean, the players don't seem to care about it anymore. The only ones that seem to care is if they have some kind of an escalator in their contract that, you know, you get voted to the Pro Bowl, you get an extra $50,000 or $100,000.
Me personally, whatever. I always liked it better when it was after the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
You know, the week after the Super Bowl. I always preferred that.
Because then you could have
one last shot at football.
Right. And then you could also have the players from the teams that were in the Super Bowl could go play, you know. Obviously, they're not going to go play in some stupid, meaningless game the week before the Super Bowl.
Right.
We do have four Vikings going. Justin Jefferson is the key one. And we had, who's the other? Dalvin Cook.
And O'Neal. And
Brian O'Neal.
Kirk Cousins is going.
And Aaron Rodgers decided that he was too injured to play this week. So Kirk Cousins was apparently next on the list.
Aaron's vagina hurt too much.
Yeah, he got too much sand in his badge or whatever. But
Vagine.
But Kirk was either next on the list or the next guy that picked up the phone when they called and asked if he wanted to come play. So,
Kirk. Oh, man. Oh, I thought this was somebody. Anyways, well, whatever. Since you're here already.
Yeah, since we got you on the phone, you want to come to Las Vegas and play in the Pro Bowl next week? I mean, like I said, nobody really cares about the
that
Pro
helps.
Bowl.
You're trying to sell the guy, man.
It does.
Denver had mentioned this in the Gallahorn earlier today about Kirk being at his apex as far as being able to get rid of him. If you're going to do it, man, this is the year to do it.
Oh, absolutely.
He had a really good point there for sure.
Yeah, it is. There's a lot of teams that are good that either are losing their quarterbacks. You know, Pittsburgh is one. Tampa Bay is now another one.
The draft you're not seeing a lot of the blue chip prospects at quarterback this year in the draft.
Yeah,
it's going to be high risk, high reward as far as quarterbacks go this year.
Yep. Now, of course, you know, there's ultimately always quarterbacks that shoot up the board after, you know, the Senior Bowl and all that other stuff.
Always. Yeah, of course. Yep.
And that's actually a good segue into the last thing we're going to talk about is there are a couple of, the draft stuff is started now in full force.
Mm-hmm.
The East-West Shrine Game will have already happened by the time you guys see this on Friday. It's Thursday night. So next week, if there's anything good from there, we can talk about that. Yep. But the bigger one is the Reese's Senior Bowl is Saturday down in Mobile, Alabama. Now, our buddy Tyler Fornes is down there. Tyler does stuff for NBC and USA Today and Climbing the Pocket Network. And he's been tweeting out a lot of stuff. Great follow if you guys aren't following him. It's The Real Forno on Twitter. Check him out. He's down at Senior Bowl. He's a big college football guy. He knows the draft stuff really well.
I'm liking what he's having to say about this guy that you're about to hit on.
Mm-hmm. And fairness and point that he was a big fan of this guy before he went down there. But he said the one quarterback that's really standing out is Liberty quarterback Malik Willis. Now, Willis is somebody that been hearing some rumblings that, you know, the Vikings could be interested in.
I've got personally right now, as of right now, from what I'm watching, because I'm starting to dig into the tape, before the draft comes up, of course, mm-hmm. educate myself.
Right.
At this point, I have Willis and Correll head in head as far as my guys at quarterback go.
Yeah. And, you know, a lot of people are putting Kenny Pickett up there too now.
Small hands.
Yeah, he's got real small hands. I mean, you know, everybody made a big deal about Joe Burrow having small hands a couple of years ago. Pickett's hands are like 3/4 of an inch shorter than Burrow's are.
Yep. And you know what happened last time we had a quarterback with small hands?
Yeah. But I've also heard comparables that Pickett's ceiling is like Alex Smith, Kirk Cousins type range. So,
right.
You know, and he's not, I mean, he's more mobile, I think, than Kirk.
He's a lot more mobile than what you would think.
But he's more of a traditional drop back passer. Whereas Malik mm-hmm. Willis is that new style, you know, a Patrick Mahomes type.
He's looking at around all over the place. Every single play.
A Josh Allen type thing. Yeah, Malik Willis does like what you call hero ball, you know, like we've talked about that. Yep. He's got that gunslinger mentality. Now he does have some accuracy issues that are going to need to be worked on, but he's an intriguing prospect. And I know Tyler speaks really highly of him.
I really like Correll too. I think he's going to surprise a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
Lane Kiffin. I mean,
yeah. And I've also
if Correll goes somewhere to, you know, Kevin O'Connell, and he can groom him. I mean, I could see Correll being a really good quarterback in this league.
Yeah. I also heard that he struggled a little bit yesterday, but in day two, Desmond Ridder started looking pretty decent today too.
Okay.
The Cincinnati quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we'll break into the draft a lot more as we get down the road.
Oh, yeah. We got a lot of time.
You know, we're just kind of bringing some of this stuff up because the Senior Bowl is this weekend. Couple other players that Tyler said stood out on Wednesday. Florida State edge rusher Jermaine Johnson. Georgia defensive tackle Devontae Wyatt. Of course, Liberty quarterback Malik Willis. Florida mm-hmm. Florida running back Damian Pierce. And UCLA tight end Greg Dulcich. Or Dulcich, okay. I don't know how you pronounce it. Now, fairness and honesty here, I know nothing about any of these guys except Malik Willis.
Right.
I haven't.
Like I said, just in these last 2 weeks, I'm not a big college football guy, but after the NFL ends, I do go and start dipping into tape. Mm-hmm. And now that I got a podcast, I'm really going to have to start dipping into tape.
Right. And because it will be our intent as we
proceed
along towards the draft here. So. You know, we want to do some draft breakdowns. We want to, you know, give you guys the honest opinion. I'm not going to pretend to be the draft breakdown expert that our buddy Drew Bunting is with Drew's Big Board.
Yes.
Although
I feel like I can see talent, you know?
Oh yeah.
So we might just be your average Joes, but we know something about football, and we'll give you our discussion and speculate as well.
It's our honest opinion. Take it for what it's worth, but
yep.
But with that, that's really about all we've got for tonight. Gonna be a little bit shorter show this week, but
it almost has to be with how today. Remember, guys, this is Wednesday night. This is when the show hit the fan.
Yeah, I'm just spent after this whole 12 hours of Harbaugh or whatever. It's for 24 hours of
it was. Harbaugh, it was so disheartening that I was so high on these three, and I was getting so excited about O'Connell or DeMeco, and then how much did Harbaugh playing the DeMeco backing out of the
I think it's a fair amount because it coincidentally they have the same agent, so
right. So I went from being like high to being like, oh, okay, we're going with Harbaugh. Okay, well, so I really like studied up on Harbaugh the last 2 days. Mm-hmm. So I spent a lot of time looking into Harbaugh for basically nothing.
Yeah. we all bought
myself up, getting excited.
We all bought into the hype. It was fun for a couple of days. Now, like I said, we're coming down off the high, and now we look forward. We're not going to sit back and say what could have been had Harbaugh came here. We're looking forward to what can be with Kevin O'Connell and Clacy Adolfo-Menza running this show, taking it in the new direction. So
let's hope we feel the same way about O'Connell as we do now about Kwesi.
Right.
You know, because I was like, oh, no, we missed out on Poles. But after seeing Poles in his presser when he got introduced to the NFL world or whatever, as far as the GM goes in Chicago.
Yep.
I'm so glad we went with Quessy.
Yeah, I am too. So, but with that, again, want to thank everybody for watching. Thank you for taking part in this journey that Lance and I are doing. Want to thank everybody who watched the live show last week. We're going to do some more of those coming up.
Oh yeah, that was fun. That was a lot of fun.
We had a good time. We have a great time interacting with you guys and everything else. If you guys are watching the show, whether it's your first time or whether you've been a longtime watcher, but have not yet hit that little red subscribe button down there, we would really appreciate it if you do so. We have the drive for 300 going. We're getting there, people, but we need you guys' help to get there. So tell your friends,
as
tell
of everybody tonight, else, we're at 240. So
like and subscribe to the channel. The more subscribers we get, the more it helps us out and the bigger and better we can make this show for all you fans out there and everybody who watches. But with that, again, want to thank our buddies Drew and Ted over at the Vikings Report. Check out their show Saturday morning at 10 a.m. They're back to their off-season time now. I was on with them. They did a live show Wednesday night.
They did a great live show earlier
today. Breaking down the whole coaching thing. Go check that out if you have a chance. It's on their YouTube page. But thank you guys for the shout-out when I was on there. Great friends of the show. They've helped us out a ton getting our show going. But again, like and subscribe to the channel. Check us out on the audio cast if you're out on the road. We're on all your standard audio podcast channels. Thank you again. And with that, why don't you take us out of here tonight, Lance?
Well, if you haven't yet, it's time to get on that Kevin O'Connell train. Let's see what he brings to the Super Bowl as far as game plan goes. I'm excited. We know where we're at now. We know who we picked. Now it's just about putting the right guys in the right spots as far as coordinators go and staff goes. So let's get her done. And with that being said, we'll see you next week. Next week, Friday. Skol.
All right. See you guys. Have a good weekend.